When I'm talking about the pull factor, I'm basically talking about our neighbor, Mexico, that unfortunately has been offering different kind of benefits, admin benefits, visas, and other kind of work permits and situations that what basically do is they enhance the interest of our Guatemalans on using Mexico and the route to get to the U.S.
Joining me now is Enrique Degenhart. He is the Minister of Governance of Guatemala. Thank you so much for being here with me, Enrique. I really appreciate your time. As you know, the crisis at the U.S.-Mexico border is worsening. We're seeing recently in El Paso 1,000 migrants in one walkover through El Paso. And this is the biggest group I think we've ever seen at one time. We had over 100,000 apprehended at the border, I believe, in April. And it doesn't seem like it's getting any better. And obviously, as you know, some of the people that are being apprehended are from Guatemala. Some are from Honduras, from El Salvador. And so this is an issue that obviously you deeply care about. And my question is, why are people fleeing Guatemala?
I guess, first of all, thank you for having me. I think that this is a good opportunity to express and explain what's going on in our country and in the region. The feelings that we have and the information that we have had with regards of why our people, and I'm talking about Guatemalans, are leaving the country is basically for a mix of different situations. Let me start by saying that our macroeconomic numbers in the country are very good. We have actually the lowest criminal rates in the country that we have had for the past 15 or 20 years, which means that it's probably not a factor of economics or security. What we have identified, and this is part of what we have to work with, is basically the pull factor and a mix of cultural situations that happen in country. When I'm talking about the pull factor, I'm basically talking about our neighbor, Mexico, that unfortunately has been offering different kind of benefits, admin benefits, visas, and other kind of work permits and situations that what basically do is they enhance the interest of our Guatemalans on using Mexico and the route to get to the U.S.
So when you said it's a pull factor, so you're saying that most of the people that are fleeing Guatemala, they're economic migrants?
I would say that most of them, yes.
So technically they wouldn't qualify for asylum like we hear President Trump say over and over again. And we know that for a fact because a lot of the people that do go to court, if they do show up, those are the ones that have real asylum claims. The other ones get turned away immediately because they don't have them.
What I would say, because we can't generalize what the reason for that is. However, we do think that most of them come here looking for jobs. I think that the boost in the economy in the U.S. is also generating interest from our Guatemalans to come up here and work and make money. But we definitely want to discourage the way that they're doing it. I mean, we implement the rule of law in the country. We, constitutionally speaking, can't prohibit them from leaving the country. However, what we have been saying is that we want them to do it on a legal basis using the actual rules of law that apply in the U.S. So it's again as a mix. I don't want to discourage the Guatemalans that do leave the country for asylum reasons, but I think that there are different processes involved that can be solved either in country or in a neighbor country that don't necessarily mean that they have to come up here on an irregular way.
This must hurt your country and working in government. Obviously, you're following this closely. When you have this amount of people fleeing your country, a lot of young people too, right?
Definitely.
How does that impact your economy when people are leaving?
Well, the problem is that we're not going to see that affecting us right now. But on the near future and in the, I would say, a few years, we're going to be skipping a generation. Because it's not only the young people, actually. When you have the problem that we actually have right now where minors are being taken on the route, and you're talking that those numbers that are detained at the southern border of the U.S. are also one of the biggest numbers in the region, that is something that we have to worry about. We understand that there has to be family reunification, because we understand that part. But we also have a feeling that there's an additional activity that we're going to eventually try to figure out if it's a criminal kind of activity or not.
Okay, so you haven't decided if that's part of it. And my question is, like, in Guatemala, are people having conversations in general saying, like, oh, it's a good time to go to the U.S.? Like, where do people get the idea that they're going to be able to get to the U.S. and stay in the U.S. and also maybe possibly get citizenship or qualify for asylum? Are there radio ads? I've heard things like that, that there are radio ads in Central America, sometimes in Mexico. Maybe sometimes the news is encouraging it. Facebook posts.
I would say that transnational criminal organizations are very well established. They have, I would say, a marketing division with which they use all the different social media channels that they have to try to put out the offers to the Guatemalans there. And definitely, a big bunch of Guatemalans use social media and get that kind of messaging from the transnational criminal organizations. So yes, that is a part again. And there's another part of the cases where they probably are misreading how the message works. And I'm going to try to explain this. You might have families in Guatemala that see pictures of their family members when they reach the U.S. And they probably think that they are very happy and that they're doing very well. But the part that they don't say is what happened in the route. We have an understanding of cases where not only females but males get raped in the route. That kind of messaging does not reach the families in Guatemala that are thinking about fleeing the country. And they don't realize the kind of risks that they take in the route. Again, as I mentioned, I remember a case that was shared with us of a male that was raped several times in the route during his going or reaching the southern border. You're talking about this might have been 20-something or 30-years-old male that was raped. That when he told the agents at the border what had happened, he was crying. And I would understand that. That's horrible.
Yeah.
But what you see afterwards is you see this individual taking pictures once he's in the U.S., sending those pictures, sitting in a nice park or on a nice vehicle, and giving the message that he's having a great life here.
Yeah. So you're in D.C., and in part of the reason you were here was because Guatemala is trying to renegotiate a regional open borders agreement to break up the caravans. Like, have you witnessed the caravans forming in Guatemala before they head over to Mexico?
Of course. I mean, our ministry had, we're in charge of the internal security. And we had several problems, even with violence, from specifically the Honduran caravans, that I would say they did not come in on an orderly, legal way. They are abruptly harmed several of my agents at the border, using, unfortunately, children and women as the front line.
Yeah, the shields.
As human shields. When you see that kind of activities and you see how they coordinate, this is not a typical immigration kind of flow. Normal flows are one or two or, let's say, a small family trying to reach Mexico. Not thousands of them,
yeah,
or hundreds of them. So that's the reason why we are analyzing an agreement that was signed. It's called CA4. The CA4 agreement was signed between four countries of Central America. That would be Nicaragua, Honduras, El Salvador, and Guatemala. And the objective of the CA4 was to improve the commercial relationship between the four countries. By doing that, of course, they needed to open a sort of a free walkthrough, meaning that anybody can go to the other country, but they have to do it legally. So the main objective of that agreement is being completely misused today. The CA4 never had as an objective the influx of thousands of people organized in one group. And for that reason, we are with our attorneys and the DHS attorneys analyzing what we can do and to what extent to avoid that kind of situations.
Yeah, I had a question. There had been discussion about maybe having people make their asylum claims at an embassy, maybe in Guatemala, so that people don't feel like they need to make it all the way to the U.S. to make that asylum claim. Is that something that you think would maybe help with this, or for people to make the asylum claims in their own country so that you don't have people coming in through Honduras?
Well, the truth of the matter is that we are actually doing that with any person that comes into country. We're serving, because, I mean, this is an international treaty.
Mm-hmm. Asylum claims for Guatemalans, that they only do it in their own country, that they don't have, you know, the ability to do it at the border.
What happens is that when you're presenting an asylum case, it basically means that you feel that your life is threatened in the country that you're from.
So. Correct.
To be able to do that, Guatemalans would have to be either in Honduras, El Salvador, Belize, or Mexico to mm-hmm. be able to process that yeah. in that U.S. embassy and those other countries. However, and again, what we're doing with any kind of asylum claim that we get is we are processing it that. So I would say that that process is being done but very effectively. By the Guatemalan government. It's under our ministry also.
Yeah.
Having an enhancement or improvement on that process, I think, would definitely help.
Okay. Well, very effectively, like, we still have, you know, 100,000 people. Not all of them are from Guatemala.
But yeah. A big percentage of them are Guatemalans, and we recognize that situation.
Why don't Guatemalans seek asylum in Mexico and just stay in Mexico? Mexico is a good country.
Yes, we think that it's a good country, but to be honest with you, Guatemalans better. They don't need to leave the country. The feeling that we have is that this kind of marketing, criminal marketing that they get attacked with on social media and by word of mouth, as you said, is really affecting us. I understand that there's always room for improvement, but you don't need to take the risks of the route to go through and put your life in the hands of any criminal organization that is going to take advantage of you. We are working very strongly with the U.S. To defining not only the way to prevent or, I would say, dismantle the criminal organizations that are moving and smuggling those migrants. But there's another angle of it. And the other angle is the reason why I'm here. We're working on not only attacking, but also preventing Guatemalans from leaving the country. Once we have that done, which after the meetings that we had today, we think that is going to happen pretty soon. That is going to be a very strong message to our society, and we hope that they understand that they don't have to go anywhere to live. Of course, they're free to do it.
Yeah.
But
they need to do it the right way. I wanted to ask you, in March, Trump moved to cut off all the foreign aid to countries like Guatemala and others. Are you preparing for that?
Well, this is a subject that we spoke about. The kind of money or funding affects on a specific scale, I guess, the kind of law enforcement activities that we're doing. But the larger percentage of that funding is being handled by NGOs that not necessarily do or work directly with the strategic lines that we have as a government. So cutting the funding really is affecting the NGOs more than what it's affecting us.
Okay. And for when it comes to aid, I always hear that if the U.S. were to be more generous when it comes to aid, specifically for Central America, that that would help with a lot of the problems. Like, do you have a number on how much that would be to solve
the president your country's problems? Morales has a saying: "We don't want money for granted." Basically, what he says is, "We don't put our hand like that. We put our hand like that." Meaning that we want to work and develop the relationship with our allies and partners. We don't want to ask for money. We have money that we're investing. Because, by the way, all the different actions that we have been taking have been actions used with our budget. We recognize and we thank the support of the different projects that we have or that are financed by the U.S. society. You're never going to say not to receive help. You're going to say thank you. However, we need and we will make sure that we can come out good with our own budget and our own resources.
If you're having 100,000 people flowing in every month, like at what point does it stop? And how bad is it going to get?
So I think that you have to draw the line. And we recognize that President Trump is doing that. We respect that. I think that you have to take that kind of bold attitude to make sure that a problem gets solved. That affects us, of course.
Yeah.
Because we know that that pressure is eventually going to be kicked at Guatemala also. But having Guatemala as a choke point, because remember, geographically speaking, our country is a bottleneck for the region. South and Central America, basically all the different illegal, illicit flows come through our country because of the way the region is made up. But that's a perfect way of controlling. If you have a natural choke point and you're able to work with an ally like ourselves, you might move your problem a little bit to the south.
I was going to ask you about that. So you can educate me on this. The Guatemalan border with Mexico is like 200 miles. Is that?
It's a little longer, but yeah, okay. It's
why is it so hard to secure that border?
Well, the disadvantage that we have is that we have jungle in a big part of it. Of course, we are still working on hiring more police agents and border patrol agents to control the illegal paths that are in between the jungle. This is something that the U.S. has been doing for several years, probably 2, 3, 4 times more time than what we are and what we have. However, the kind of agreements that we reached with the DHS secretary today and through the MOU that was signed last Monday, we're going to be getting support, knowledge transfer, and best practices from Border Patrol, CBP, criminal investigative, federal agents that are going to come down into country and are going to support us to try to close that, what you just said.
Yeah, I saw, I read a report that DHS officials were heading down there.
Yes.
To give intelligence, or?
It's, I would say.
Do you need to build a wall?
Well, you know what? This is going to be probably not a physical wall, but it's going to be a wall.
Because we saw the video, I mean, I can't forget it, where the fence was basically just kind of pushed down. And you saw the agents trying to protect the border, and there really wasn't much they could do when there was just thousands of people storming through. I mean, we'll never forget the bridge video of the thousands of people walking through. I've never seen anything like it.
Unfortunately, what happened, and this is part of the criminal way of doing business, they had women and children in the front, as you mentioned, as human shields. When that happens, the protocols that our law enforcement agency can use is a completely different one. because you can never put them in harm's way, even if you have a bunch of criminals behind them.
Yeah.
So that part is something that we're also learning how to deal with. And I'm going back to the CA4 that I mentioned. We have to do choke points all through our countries, in country in Guatemala, so that when the group reaches, if it reaches our northern border,
they can't just all be there at the same time.
Definitely.
Have you been? Have you done any sort of border tours by the U.S.-Mexico border, especially like the San Diego sector? Like those type of fences work. I mean, that really keeps people out.
Well, we are, and by the way, we have a trip coming up very soon that we're going to have in Texas, where we're going to go and check on the new technology that we're going to start using for the DNA identifying of the miners. I think that's going to be a game changer. We've seen the results on the pilot program that was developed here.
Yeah.
We had the advantage of having our First Lady as a leader in that part. Our First Lady, she is very sensitive and sensible about our children being used as merchandise. So we're going to be very soon in Texas to do a survey of how the border has been handled.
Yeah, and obviously this is a huge issue. We could sit here and talk for hours, but obviously we don't have the time for that. So just remind me the three biggest things that Guatemala is doing right now to get a handle on the caravans.
I would say, first of all, the legal analysis of the CA4, I think that is a game changer. The kind of actions we're going to take to make sure that minors don't get abused, don't get sold. I'll give you a small example. There's a case of a Central American, I'm not going to say the nationality, but a 50-year-old guy went and bought a six-month-old baby. He bought it for $100.
Wow.
And that's how he wanted to come in through our country and to reach the border in the U.S. Through the pilot program that DHS implemented, that guy got identified and prosecuted.
Good.
That's the kind of reactions that we need, and that's the kind of commitment that we as a Guatemalan government have towards national security, but not only our national security, the regional national security.
And then the third one?
The third one would be to handle or to get Mexico engaged on a different game plan. If they don't change the way they're doing business with regard to offering that kind of benefits, it's going to be difficult to reduce the numbers, because we might be choking the flows in our country for the rest of the people trying to walk through. Mm-hmm. But if those offers to our nationals are still appealing, it's going to be very difficult for us to reduce those numbers.